Welcome to Brookings on a beautiful Friday afternoon. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to this afternoon's event. My name is Richard Bush. I'm the director of the Center for Northeast Asian Policy Studies here at Brookings. We're very privileged this afternoon to hear an address by His Excellency Toshimitsu Motegi, who is the Minister of Economy, Trade, and Industry in the Government of Japan. He will speak on economic growth, energy, and economic partnership, Japan's current obstacles and new opportunities. After the minister speaks, my colleague, Dr. Mireya Solis, will moderate the discussions, and we need to end promptly at 3:50. I think there's biographical information about Minister Motegi outside. I will just say that he is a graduate of Tokyo University in 1978. He received a master's from the John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. He is now in his seventh term as a member of Japan's lower house. He has served in a variety of ministerial and vice ministerial positions in the government and also policy executive positions in the Liberal Democratic Party. He became Minister of Economy and Trade and Industry in December of last year. Without further ado, welcome to Minister Motegi.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. It is my honor to be given an opportunity to introduce Japan's effort as a Brookings Institute, fair opinion leaders here in the United States and all over the world get together. Everyone has a dream that one wants to try even once in a life. If you are a singer, it might be to hold a solo concert at Carnegie Hall. If you are an actor, it might be to play the role of James Bond or 007. But you might better switch Aston Martin to another car, as it is not a perfect car for daily use. However, since the TPP negotiations are getting into a crucial and sensitive stage, I'm not going to suggest which car you may change. One of my dreams since my Kennedy School days has been to give a speech here at the Brookings. Yet, getting beaten up in the Q&A session is not a part of my dream. Well, in the 4 months since the inauguration of Prime Minister Abe's administration, our new administration has taken politically tough actions at an unprecedented speed, such as bold monetary policy and the entry into TPP negotiations. Japan's economy has started to show promising signs. For example, Nikkei stock average has risen by 50% since last November. The cabinet approval rating is marking 76%. I see this is a reflection of strong expectation of Japanese people for new administration's economic policy, namely Abenomics. To turn such an expectation into strong confidence, what will be the road? Instead of road, I'd rather use a word with more straight connotation, street, because it is a keyword for today's speech. STR in the street represent strategy. Strategy for what? The first E is a strategy for economic growth. Second E is a strategy for energy. And finally, the T stands for strategy for trade liberalization. I begin with strategy for economic growth. Abenomics is to shoot three arrows strongly at the same time, namely bold monetary easing, flexible fiscal policy, and growth strategy to stimulate business investment. As the first arrow, Mr. Kuroda, new governor of the BOJ, introduced very bold monetary easing on the dimension we have never seen. This is to overcome the Japan's prolonged deflation as early as possible. This new policy is never targeted on the exchange rate. Only the market decides the exchange rate. Anyway, the first arrow seems to be within the range of the mark of ending deflation. The second arrow, targeting at reversing economic recession, is to make a seamless execution of two budgets, namely our supplementary budget of over 100 billion US dollar and the current fiscal year's regular budget, which has passed the House of Representatives. This second arrow has also reached a cruising speed smoothly. I suppose that the most important and what you want to hear the most today may be the third arrow, growth strategy. I'd like to mention 2 points about the growth strategy here. The first is to open new frontier of Japanese economy. And the second is facilitating metabolism of Japanese economy. What do I mean by new frontiers of Japanese economy? For example, Japan is now facing a challenge of aging society. By developing new frontiers of Japanese economy, Japan turns this challenge into an opportunity for developing new business in a wide range of health and welfare areas. I'd like to introduce Japan's initiative that we call the healthiest and longest life in the world. For example, suppose someone suffered spinal cord injury, due to a traffic accident. He has to rely on the wheelchair. But with the application of iPS cells, his nerves can be regenerated and he can walk again. Another example is a working assistance robot named Robot Sweetheart. This robot has been developed by a Japanese venture company. Suppose those who have difficulty in walking due to the old age or injury put on the suit. The robot senses bioelectrical signals generated when the user intends to move the legs. Then the robot moves its joints in sync with the user's movement. Now, the user can walk again. The government have been a driving force for these initiatives through providing R&D and other assistance. The new frontiers also include changing energy constraint to a breakthrough of much safer, more economical, and more efficient energy technology for a new economic growth. I will come back to energy issues later. Second, Japan will stimulate the metabolism of Japanese economy to implement structural reform for growth. We will support business efforts toward their own structural reform. We will also intensively implement a variety of measures in taxation and regulatory systems to facilitate the transfer of business resources and labor forces from conventional to growing industries. In addition, we will develop new markets through regulatory reforms. We are considering a new approach called International Top Runner Test in pursuing regulatory reform. When there is a gap between domestic regulations and international standards, we bring the domestic regulations into line with the international standard unless there are good reasons to maintain domestic regulations. As almost 150 years has passed since the end of isolationist period of the Tokugawa Shogunate, we just cannot allow regulation to become closed to the outside world again. The second E is the strategy for energy. Nuclear energy accounts for 30% of Japan's power generation before the Great East Japan earthquake. It now stands at only 2%. The amount of power generation lost is equivalent to nearly twice the amount of electricity consumed in New York State. It is replaced by thermal power generation. Japan has to rely about 90% of energy demand on fossil fuels. We import all of them from overseas. It certainly is not sustainable. This situation is in stark contrast to the United States, as the U.S. heads toward energy independence, supported by its shale revolution. Energy is a lifeline for vibrant industrial activities and prosperous lives of people. The key elements to overcome the energy supply constraint and to ensure stable and economical energy production are diversification of fuel supplies, enhancement of efficiency of thermal power generation, and utilization of nuclear energy. The high natural gas price is a main cause for Japan to experience trade deficit for the first time in the 31 years. The price in Japan is 4 or 5 times higher than in the United States. If LNG can be imported from the U.S. with growing production of shale gas, it makes a lot of difference for Japan to diversify fuel supply sources and shrink the price gap. This is not a problem only for Japan. Energy demand is expanding rapidly throughout Asia. Therefore, new flow of LNG supply from the U.S. to Asia is an essential game changer that would contribute to energy security as well as to economic and geopolitical stability in Asia. I will explain a bit more details on Japan's nuclear energy policy. First of all, I'd like to express our appreciation to American people for Tomodachi Initiative that has been extended in response to TEPCO's Fukushima nuclear power plant accident. I'm sure Tomodachi Initiative strengthened heart-to-heart ties between peoples of Japan and the United States. Abe administration will review from scratch the policies of the former administration that targets zero nuclear power in the 2030s will be structured and build responsible energy policy with a strong determination for safety that will never repeat the accident and the recognition that we are leader of nuclear non-proliferation efforts. To date, Japan has been contributing to peaceful use of nuclear power and its non-proliferation in tandem with the US. We feel it our responsibility to share the experience and lessons learned from the accident with the rest of the world. We thus can contribute to safe and peaceful use of nuclear energy worldwide, given an increasing number of new nuclear power plants under planning. We will remain committed through exporting nuclear power plants of the highest safety standards. Let me touch on the decommissioning of the TEPCO's Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant. It is an unprecedented case in the world involving various challenges. We therefore will not leave this work to the utility alone. Instead, our government will take a leading role in the field of R&D. In tackling with this challenge, Japan will keep the information open and get wisdom from all over the world, including the US. Last year, based on the determination of our diet, Japan established an independent regulatory body, Nuclear Regulation Authority, following the case of the US. This authority has introduced series of strict regulations and is now known as the strictest organization to utilities in Japan. I'd rather call it JNRA, not simply NRA. The safety of nuclear power plants is left to professional and scientific judgment by JNRA. Unless safety is assured by it, it will not restart nuclear reactors. On the other side, once safety is assured, we'll move forward to their restart. The US has built a system which encourages the nuclear industry's voluntary and continuous efforts of improving safety after the Three Mile Island accident. It includes the establishment of the Institute of Nuclear Power Operations, INPO, and the introduction of performance-based regulation. We will enhance international cooperation and aim to achieve the highest standards of safety in the world through our industries, voluntary and continuous effort. In doing so, utilization of probabilistic risk assessment, PRA, will be very important as a tool to measure safety at each plant objectively. The quantitative risk assessment by PRA will enable us to depart from the so-called safety myth, which is a belief that there exists no risk if nuclear power plant satisfy regulatory standard. PRA will encourage the industry's voluntary and continuous effort and will also enable us to explain risk mitigation efforts by objective figures. The Japan-US Cooperation for Nuclear Safety Enhancement will contribute to sound development of nuclear industries of the world in a manner compatible with non-proliferation. Eventually, it will also contribute to strengthen national security of both countries. For this reason, I'd like to propose to set up a forum under Japan-US Bilateral Committee on Civil Nuclear Cooperation for discussing and exchanging views on the effort of safety improvement by industries. The U.S. have been and will be our most important partner when tackling with our challenges of the energy crisis. The only regret during my visit to the U.S. this time is that Dr. Minitz, a nominee for Secretary of Energy, is not in office yet. I trust that the top of the piled up documents that he has to sign upon taking the position will be the energy export license to Japan. I'm sure I'll be able to work together with him in a win-win manner. I look forward to contributing to stable, economical, and sustainable energy development on a global scale through the Japan-US cooperation. The third part of the street, T, is strategy for trade liberalization. Japan is on track to join the TPP negotiations as the US government notified Congress of interest to include Japan in negotiation on April 24th. We hope that Japan can contribute to the discussion in the round expected to be held in July. We will contribute to the rulemaking in the Asia-Pacific region together with countries that share the same value, particularly with the U.S. At the same time, Japan promotes the variety of economic partnership in all dimensions, including Japan-EU-EPA, RCEP, and Japan-China-Korea trilateral FTA. We will play a strong leadership role to realize FTAP, Free Trade Area of Asia-Pacific. Here, there is a point that we should be mindful of. As mega FTAs such as TPP, US-EU FTA, and Japan-EU EPA are spreading mainly among developed countries, it might be possible in the future that these mega FTAs conflict with each other. Another possibility might be that North-South issues arise between developed countries and developing countries left out of mega FTAs. Japan is proceeding with economic leadership partnership with countries ranging from developed to developing countries and hope to serve as a mediator to address these concerns. The trade liberalization is not just about FTA. It includes facilitating cross-border cooperation and connecting one country to another in a broad sense. For example, Japan has promoted broad area infrastructure building that can support spreading supply chains across national borders. One example of building roads and ports which connect Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand, and Myanmar. Another example is developing Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor in India. Japan has strongly supported such dynamic cross-border infrastructure building. Through these efforts, supply chains in Asia has been strengthened. Japan, together with the US, has supported the progress toward democracy in Myanmar. We hope to expand such successful Japan-US cooperation to worldwide cooperation, not limited to in Myanmar. In the context of global cooperation between Japan and the U.S., I'd like to promote Japan-U.S. cooperation for leading the world in strategic sector, leveraging our excellent technologies and competitive industries. One example is in the areas of cybersecurity. Last year, Japan established public-private initiatives for cybersecurity information shared partnership to protect important infrastructure from cyber attacks. This information sharing framework is joined by 39 organizations covering 5 sectors of heavy industry: power, gas, petroleum, and chemical. Under the framework, 246 cases were reported last year, and it helped prevention of security impairment and enhancement of countermeasures. Japan will promote cooperation with the U.S., including sharing best practice R&D and human resources development. In addition, Japan has a variety of advanced dual-use technologies which should be invaluable even in the defense sector. For example, carbon fiber, as light and strong materials, is used for aircraft body. Second is robot that functions effectively in disasters. METI would like to support cooperation in the strategic industry sectors between Japan and the U.S. while maintaining the firm position of Japan as a peaceful nation. Do I have 15 more minutes? No. 3 more minutes. Let's think about the future for a while. What the world in the 2050 will look like? According to ADB, GDP of China will be $63 trillion, India $40 trillion, and Asia will account for 52% of the world GDP. At that point, the US GDP will be around the same as that of India. Furthermore, GDP per capita in the entire Asia region will reach $40,800. It is approximately at the same level as in today's Europe. If this projection comes true, the pivot will shift toward Asia. This scenario, however, is subject to many different risks. There are various elements of uncertainties, such as increasing gap between the rich and the poor, depletion of resources, environmental deterioration, and the change in geopolitical balance. How should Japan and the U.S. react to immense growth of Asia? When heading to a new land or a new frontier, the most important thing is the close ties, kizuna, among the pioneers. I believe Japan-U.S. alliance should be the pivot of those expeditions. Our Prime Minister Abe stated, "Japan is back." If Japan, which is back, and the United States now walk together, we will be followed by a new street, plus ultra, meaning further beyond, is another Latin word I like as much as veritas of the Harvard coat of arms. This street will lead to Broadway that brings about peace, stability, and prosperity in the Asia-Pacific region. We will never enjoy peace and stability without assuring not only national security, but energy and cybersecurity. Similarly, we will never enjoy prosperity without TPP, which is to lead up to FTAP through applying new rules. This will further facilitate trade and investment in this region. Japan and the U.S. share the same values, including freedom, democracy, human rights, and rules of law. I very much look forward to drawing 100-year plan for the Asia-Pacific region and trending on the street of state of stable peace and prosperous Asia-Pacific region together with the U.S. Thank you very much.
Okay, the mic is on. Thank you so much, Minister Motegi. May I say that your dream is our dream, and we're really delighted to have you here at Brookings. And thank you so much for such a rich presentation. And I think there's so much, I'm sure that people here have so many questions. And now we're going to turn to that portion of the program, and I would like to take the opportunity to ask the first question this afternoon. And I think that these are very exciting times in Japan, as the Abe administration has put forward a number of economic policies that could indeed have a transformational effect so that Japan can overcome deflation and slow growth. And I think, Minister Motegi, as you pointed out in your remarks, the component of structural reform is really essential to the success of this economic strategy. Now, I think that there are some people that are a little bit skeptical about what could be the results of the third arrow in the Abenomics program, because they point out to the fact that previous governments in Japan have called upon the need for structural reform, but that due to institutional inertias or other obstacles, sometimes these efforts have been bogged down. Now, in my mind, this time, the campaign at structural reform is qualitatively different from what it has been attempted in the past, partly because I see a very positive synergy between the domestic reform agenda and Japan's participation in very ambitious trade agreements like the TPP and the negotiation with Europe. But my question to you, Minister Motegi, is how would you respond to those people out there who may be a little bit skeptical about the chances of structural reform in Japan finally gaining traction? What could be different this time as the Abe government undertakes these very, very ambitious and positive economic policies?
前の政権と比べて、はい、構造改革。前の政権と比べるまでもないことなんですけれど、政権交代からまだ4ヶ月ですけれど、実際に株価、そして民間の投資始め、結果が出始めていると。これは間違いない。そして日本の国民のマインド、
Well, maybe it's not even necessary to compare what we can do with what the previous administration did. In the 4 months after the inauguration of Abe administration, we have already been able to deliver some outcome, like more than 50% rise in the Nikkei average index, and also increase in the business investment. And at the same time, I believe there is a sign of changes in the perception and mindset of Japanese consumers.
何度もそれは以前の自民党政権の時代もそして民主党政権の時代も作ってきました。しかし現政権において大切なことは立派な成長戦略のパッケージ、その紙をまとめることではありません。
Well, about growth strategy, during former LDP government as well as under DPJ government, the growth strategy has been formulated and being pursued. But what makes a difference right now is not to prepare a beautiful growth strategy package.
あの、大切なことは我々にとって結果を出すことです。そして結果を出すのに必要な改革をやることだと思っています。
What makes a difference is for us to deliver. And for us to be able to deliver, what is important is reform, including regulatory reform.
先ほどの iPS のですね、あの講演の中で iPS の細胞の、あの話を若干させていただきましたが、あの昨年山中教授がですね、ノーベル賞を取ったようにですね、研究においては日本は iPS 細胞の研究は一番進んでいると思います。
Well, I made a reference to iPS cells during my speech, and last year, Professor Yamanaka of Japan was awarded the Nobel Prize. And in that sense, I think I can say Japan is most advanced in the area of research on iPS cells.
研究は進んでるんですけど、その iPS を使ったですね、再生医療であったりとかの実用化は日本は遅れてまして、まだ実用化された製品は日本は2つしかありません。お隣の韓国は9つあります。ヨーロッパは25あります。アメリカは治験だけやってるもんでも今88あります。
Well, research is advanced in Japan, but on the other hand, Japan is not that advanced in the application or commercialization of this very basic technology. For instance, we've got only two such cases of application or commercialization, whereas there are 9 in Korea, 25 in Europe, and 88 in the United States.
どこに問題があったかと。これは日本の今の制度、法律に問題がある。そういうことでこの国会でもう薬事法の改正を行うことにいたしました。
So where has been the bottleneck in Japan for the lack of such a commercialization? It, I believe, has been due to the institution, system, laws and regulations in Japan. Therefore, we decided to submit and pass the pharmaceutical business law to address these concerns.
6月に成長戦略の取りまとめを行いますけど、6月を待たずにやれることは果敢に実行していく。これが安倍政権の新しい特徴だと思っています。
Well, in June, we are going to formulate and announce a growth strategy package, but we are not going to wait until June for what we can do now, and we'll be bold and courageous in implementing whatever we think we can do right now without waiting for this package.
Thank you very much, Minister Motegi. So now I would like to take some questions from the audience. I would like to remind everybody to please wait for the microphone to reach you to identify yourself.And to ask a short question since we are really pressed for time. So, who would like to ask a question of Mr. Minister Motegi? The gentleman over there.
Hi, Richard Sheen with Economist Incorporated. You mentioned that you're having a FTA with China and Korea. There's discussions of that. And I was wondering if you have plans to expand that into creating maybe a regional economic zone, something very similar to European Union for Asia. And just wanted to get your perspective, prospective on that.
ありがとうございます。先ほど私の英語の発音が悪かったのかもしれないんですけれど、RCEP、これはご案内の通りですね、ASEAN 諸国、さらには、日米韓、そしてインドも巻き込むものでありまして、これもしっかりと進めていきたい、こんなふうに思ってます。
Well, thank you very much for the question. Maybe my pronunciation during the speech was not very proper, but I made a reference to RCEP, which stands for Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. That means that is sort of endeavor you have just suggested in your question of creating a community in the Asia-Pacific region, including ASEAN plus Japan, China, Korea, India.
おそらく最終的には FTAP というですね、高い頂があります。そこにアジア太平洋の国々が、登っていくということでありますけど、その登り方、さまざまな、方面からの登り方がある。 私は今 TPP が一番メインなラインにはなっていると思いますけれど、 RCEP であったり違った方向からそれぞれが登っていって頂上を目指す、こういった努力が必要だと思っています。
Well, the eventual destination for all of us in the region is to achieve EFTA, a free trade area of the Asia Pacific. I believe I can compare this to the summit or the peak of the mountains. And I think there are many roads and paths to climb up to the summit. And the TPP, I believe, is one of the main ones at this moment. But RCEP is another pathway, and there can be others too.
Thank you very much. Over there.
Hi, thank you, Mr. Minister. My name is Jim Berger from Washington Trade Daily. As you probably know, there's a lot of skeptics, especially in Washington, about whether Japan can put forward an aggressive regulatory reform package and make some changes that will have real meaning in the trade, in the Trans-Pacific partnership. Can you tell us if Japan is ready to bargain quickly in July, perhaps, on some major issues, and so it will not delay these negotiations?
TPP に関連してはですね、前政権では2年間かかりましたけど、結局参加の表明をすることができませんでした。しかし安倍政権においてはですね、昨年の12月26日に成立して、もう2月の段階では日米首脳会談でですね、TPP について相当前向きなところまで行き、3月15日には参加表明、非常に速いスピードで物事が進んでいると思います。
Well, about TPP, in the previous administrationIt took 2 years for them to discuss the pros and cons of participating in TPP without being able to make an announcement for Japan's participation in the negotiations. But under Abe administration, which came into power on December 26th last year, already in February at the Japan-US leaders meeting between President Obama and Prime Minister Abe,there was a very positive comment made by Prime Minister Abe vis-a-vis TPP participation. And already on March the 15th, Japan made a public announcement for its will to participate. So the speed in this new administration has been very prompt.
実際に日本がいつからですね、この TPP 交渉に参加できるか、これはすでに参加している11カ国の国内手続きによりますが、日本としては一刻も早く参加をしてですね、非常に高いレベルのこの地域のですね、経済連携に対して貢献をしていきたいと考えています。
Well, I don't know when actually Japan can participate substantively in the TPP negotiations. We are still waiting for the completion of the domestic procedures of 11 member countries. But we hope to be able to participate in the negotiations substantially as soon as possible so that Japan can make a contribution to high-level agreement in the form of a TPP.
もちろん日本だけではなくて、それぞれの国にセンシティブなエリアというのはあります。しかしこの TPP においては、すべての物品を交渉のテーブルに乗せると、その上で交渉を進める、そして高いレベルの経済連携をしていくということでは、日本を含め各国が共有している、思いを共有していると考えています。
Having said this, of course, Japan, as well as other members, have their own domestic sensitivities. But the goal shared by all the members of TPP is to achieve high level of economic partnership to be reached. And I think it is shared by Japan and as well as by other countries. Japan hopes to be able to make a contribution along that line.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for one more question from the audience. Yes.
Hello, my name is Adam B. Sudi. I'm with Inside US Trade. I had a question about the Japan and the U.S. set up a special bilateral consultations with each other in parallel to the TPP negotiations. And one of those, one of the commitments that was made, I think last month between the two sides, was that the U.S. would be able to maintain its auto tariffs for as long as the longest phase out of any product. Now, does this pressure Japan to consider a phase out for its sensitive agriculture products within a reasonable time so that they can take advantage of the auto tariff phase out? Because I guess it seems to put Japan in a position to have the tariff, a reasonable phase out, so they can take advantage of an auto tariff phase out. And just like your comments on that. Thank you.
あの、日米間のですね、あの事前協議については、日本がTPPに参加するか否か、もしくはその、これを決める以前の段階からアメリカが関心を示してきた項目である、このように考えています。
Well, I believe the point you have just raised is the one which was also raised during consultations between Japan and the United States before the announcement by Japan of its will to participate in the negotiation. But it has always been a long-standing interest of the United States, even before this.
そしてそれはあくまで2国間の問題としてこれまでも協議してきた問題だと思っております。
I believe this is the issue that we have been dealing with as a bilateral issue for quite some time already.
同時に2月の日米首脳会談におきましては、日本は一定の農産品、そしてアメリカは一定の工業製品についてセンシティビティがあるといったことも両国の首脳が確認をいたしました。
And in the February meeting between the President of the United States and the Prime Minister of Japan, the leaders confirmed that Japan has a certain sensitivity of agricultural products, whereas the U.S. has a sensitivity of a certain manufactured products.
私も各国の貿易担当大臣といろんな議論をしておりますけれど、それぞれの国が 様々な分野で特徴あるセンシティビティを持っている、このような話を聞いております。
I have had discussions, trade talks with the counterpart ministers of various countries, and I understand that all of them have their own unique sensitivities domestically.
日米の自動車の問題につきましては、2国間で基本的な合意をいたしました。しかし全体の関税の問題、非関税の問題については、 先ほど私が申し上げたように、すべての品目を交渉のテーブルに載せる、そこの中で議論をして結果を出す、それに尽きると思っております。
Well, there was a basic agreement on auto issue between Japan and the United States on a bilateral basis, but as to the tariff and how to deal with the tariff and non-tariff issues, including all of them, all the products will be put on the negotiating table, and during the negotiation, the decision will be made.
Thank you very much, Minister Motegi. I think that we are out of time. I would like to, well, if you can stay longer.
One or two more questions,
wonderful. So why don't we, all right, and immediately the hands shoot out. So this gentleman and then this gentleman. We take those two together so that we save time that way. Yes, this young gentleman with glasses.
Thank you, Minister Motegi. I'm from South Korea. My name is Joe, and I'd like to ask a question regarding the FTA. The TPP, right now, South Korea and United States has FTA, and it has a one-year anniversary. So far, during the procedure, it has some structural conflicts and domestic unrest, and that was being accorded in the process. So I believe that Japan had the same kind of, same kind of hardships that had been faced. So, could you explain more about how you get through those kind of conflicts?
Thank you. And
is that okay? Okay, and then we'll take this one, and then we'll ask the minister to respond to both of them. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kevin Buck from Clearview Energy Partners. Thank you, Minister Motegi, for your presentation. My question was, you mentioned that you regretted you hadn't had a chance to speak with Dr. Moniz yet, and you were looking forward to working with him. I saw media reports that you may have been at the DOE. I wondered if you had any updates on the discussion towards LNG exports you might be willing to share. Thank you.
I just received sensitive questions.
まず米韓のFTAで相当その韓国も苦労したということですけれど、ポイントというのはですね、守りだけでやっぱりダメだということだと私は思ってます。
Well, it seems that in achieving a chorus, there are difficulties to be overcome by the two countries. I believe that just being on the defensive is not good enough.
日本としては国益守るべき分野は守っていかなきゃなりませんが、同時に例えば農業であっても日本にも優れた製品であったりとか優れた技術、そういったものがたくさんあります。そういったのをもっと世界に打って出るような農業にしていかなければいけない、こういった思いでですね取り組みをしていきたいと思っています。
Well, as Japan, in the national interest, we feel that we should protect what we should protect. But even in the agriculture area, which we seem to be considered to be on the defensive, but I think we should also be on the offensive in the agriculture area because we have excellent farm products as well as agriculture technology that can compete in the global market.
エネルギーの問題については、今日ポネマン代行とですね、原子力だけではなくて、エネルギー全般について日米の協力関係、それをさらにですね、高めていく、同時に広げていく、こういったことで合意をいたしました。On
energy issues, I met with Acting Secretary Poneman of Energy today, and we agreed in the meeting that we would make Japan-US cooperation, including nuclear and other energy areas, to a higher level, as well as to broaden the area of cooperation.
今、発電の9割を 化石燃料に頼っている日本にとって、エネルギーの調達先の多角化、そしてまた価格の低廉化、極めて重要な問題であります。
Because we get 90% of the power generated from fossil fuel. Therefore, for Japan, with this sort of energy structure, energy supply source diversification and cost reduction are of great importance.
米国は日本の同盟国として、そして同時に今申し上げたようなエネルギー分野でですね、様々な協力関係にある国として、こういった日本の今の状況、そしてアメリカのシェールガスに対する期待、十分踏まえた上で審査を加速してもらえると、そのように思っております。
The United States is a very important ally for Japan, and between the U.S. and Japan, we have a very vigorous and excellent bilateral cooperation in energy areas. Therefore, I trust and hope that the U.S. would be mindful of the current Japanese critical energy situation and that we have a great expectation of being able to import LNG from the United States, underpinned by shale gas development in this country.
Thank you very much. Now, in closing, I would like, first of all, to ask everybody to stay in your seats so that Minister Motegi can exit. He has other meetings, but as a reward for your patience, when you actually exit the auditorium, you will find copies of the minister's speech that you can then take and read more carefully. And I would like to ask you to please join me in thanking Minister Motegi for such a wonderful presentation today.